صداقتیں اسلام کچھ بھی ہو جائیں گے ہم جہاں بھی کے جانا پڑے جانا پڑے ہمیں.
Assalamu alaikum and welcome to another live and interactive program of Beacon of Truth. Now, over the last few weeks, we've been discussing a crucial and vital topic which has its very roots from the inception of prophethood in the earth, and that of course being Khilafat. Now, just like all other prophets who came to the world, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also had divine successorship after his demise, Khilafat. And interestingly enough, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam actually panned out the chain of events which were to follow his demise regarding Khilafat. And so I would like to quote the blessed words of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about Khilafat. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stated, and I quote, "Prophethood shall remain among you as long as Allah shall will. He will bring about its end and follow it with Khilafat on the precept of prophethood for as long as he shall will, and then bring about its end. A tyrannical monarchy will then follow and will remain among you as long as Allah shall will, and then come to an end. There will follow thereafter monarchical despotism to last as long as Allah shall will and come to an end upon his decree." The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the end said, "There will then emerge Khilafat on the precept of prophethood." The Holy Prophet said no more. This is from Musnad Ahmad. In today's program, we will be discussing the Khilafat of the promised Messiah, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, may peace be upon him, and how exactly his Khilafat, which by the grace of God is still with us today, is the Khilafat which the Holy Prophet ﷺ referred to in the hadith I've just mentioned. And to take this discussion further, I have with me an esteemed two guests with me. On the right hand side, I have Ibrahim Ikhlaf Sahib, who is head of the Arabic desk in the United Kingdom. And to my left, I have Mustansir Kamil Sahib, who is a graduate from Jamia Ahmadiyya, United Kingdom. Assalamu alaikum to you both, and jazakallah for coming. So, getting straight into the discussion, Mustansir Sahib, the hadith which I just read out doesn't categorically and clearly mention, you know, the name of the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, and that he will be, you know, the prophet who would come after me, and after him there will be his Khilafat. So why is this? Why do we not see a clear mention?
Fatih, so I think it's important to remember, because the hadith clearly states that in the beginning, when it talks about the prophethood, it says the first words are takunun nabuwatu fikum ma sha Allahu an takuna, that there'll be prophethood amongst you as long as Allah shall will, and then he'll raise it up, and then thumma takunu khilafatun ala minhajin nabuwa, then after that there will be Khilafat on the precepts of prophethood. Now the question arises, then it talks about the monarchical despotism and the kingship. Yeah. And then it, at the end of the hadith, it says that there'd be ثُمَّ تَكُونُ خِلَافَةٌ عَلَىٰ مِنْهَاجِ النَّبُوَةِ. Now here, when it says there'd be Khilafat on the precepts of prophethood, yeah, it doesn't say تَكُونُ نَبُوَةُ again. Now what is the reason for that? Because we must remember that in this hadith, it is clearly mentioned that we should remember that the promised Messiah alayhi salam was in actual fact a khalifa of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who had attained the status of an ummati prophet.
Yeah.
And that's why the promised Messiah alayhi salam being a khalifa, and he's also mentioned himself as Khatamul Khulafa,
yeah,
which means the greatest of the khulafa.
Right, we alluded to this point in the last program also.
Exactly, so that's why he being a khalifa himself of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam being within the confines of Islam and the teachings of Islam, he has also being been referred to in this, because we find in many places in the Holy Quran and Ahadith the promise of an advent of the Messiah and the Imam Mahdi. And we all know that that Imam Mahdi, that promised Messiah, as mentioned in a hadith, for example, in Sahih Muslim, he's been called Nabiullah four times in one hadith.
Right.
So the promised Messiah alayhi salam was to be a prophet, but he was also to be a Khalifa. And this is nothing different, because the prophets who came after the in the Mosaic dispensation, they were prophets, but they were also Khalifas of the message of the Prophet Moses. They were prophets, but they also taught the law of the Torah, the teachings of Moses alayhi salam. So there's no it's within the practice of Allah that he also makes some prophets Khalifas who carry on the message as well. Ibrahim, so
brother, I want to add to this point. I think Mustansir explained it very well. You see, if suppose we read it in other way, ثُمَّ تَكُونَ النَّبُوَّةِ ثُمَّ تَكُونَ خِلَافَةَ عَلَى مِنْهَاجِ النَّبُوَّةِ. The difficult point of here, there will be some kind of misconception that the people will think that this kind of nabuwa, which will be claimed by the Mahdi or the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wassalam, that will be an independent prophethood. Right. The Holy Quran, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was, you know, the Aisha radiallahu anha said about him, he's the walking Quran. And he is the one who understood the Quran in depth. In reality, this is also an explanation of that verse in the Surah Al-Jumu'ah, where Allah clearly mentioned that he will raise Muhammad twice.
Right.
Very interesting, if you allow me to go into this verse of the Holy Quran. Allah says, it is he, huwa alladhi ba'atha fil ummiyina rasulan. It is he, I will explain it, no need to read it, just imam. He is, it is Allah who raised Muhammad among the illiterate ones, you know, to show them the signs, to purify them, to teach them luqan and wisdom. Then Allah says, wa akharina minhum lamma yalhaqu bihim. I will read for the translation for this. And from among, and among others, from among them who have not yet joined them.
Yeah.
The Sahaba were sitting with Muhammad, and this is mentioned in the most authentic compilation of a hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari. They were, who could understand this verse better than the Holy Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When they were sitting and they asked Muhammad, I make it short, Abu Huraira, you understand, narrates this. Yeah. We were sitting with Muhammad, all were the Arabs, and there was someone among them, you know, some foreigners among them, Salman al-Farisi, the Persian.
Right.
Salman the Persian. And they asked Muhammad, who are you? In their mind, is Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because he said, وَآخَرِينَ مِنْهُمْ لَمَّا يَلْحَقُوا بِهِمْ. Are you, in reality, in my own words, then, is he going to be raised again? Who are these people? وَآخَرِينَ مِنْهُمْ. Again, they asked, مَرَّ ثَانِيَ, second time, third time. It seems as if Muhammad was waiting for revelation from God. Then he said, he put his hand عَلَى سَلْمَان, on Salman. Then he said, لَوْ كَانَ الْإِيمَانُ مُعَلَّقًا عِنْدَ ثُرَيَّ لَنَالَهُ رَجُلٌ مِنْ هَؤُلَاءِ. Even if the faith, not Islam, the faith, the spirit, went totally ascended to the heavens, to the Pleiades, someone among these people, the Faris who will be Persian, will bring it back. Which means he, Muhammad himself explained it, that at the latter times, someone will be there who will be a Persian, who will be a non-Arab, who will be the Mahdi in this, and he is the one who has been mentioned as a second coming of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is why it was not necessary, in that sense, as Brother Mustansir Sahib said, because as a part of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the same tree, that means he will be his Khalifa, he will be born in this Ummah, there was no need. And Masih Ma'ud goes deep, he says, since I am the Holy Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, by way of reflection, buruz, and all his perfections and excellences, including his prophethood, are reflected in the mirror of my ziliya, the liya. Where then is the person who claimed to be an independent prophet? In that sense, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam just said, ثُمَّ تَكُونَ خِلَافَ عَلَى مِنْهَاجِ النَّبُوَةِ. That means Masih Maud will be the Khalifa of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and in the meanwhile, he will be the Khalifatullah. Why? Because that chain was broken in order to unite that the latter part with the early part. It was necessary that he will be a prophet in order to let that chain of Khilafat continue, Khilafat Rashida.
Right, so essentially what we're saying is, like Muslim Sahib started off, there were so many ahadith, verses of the Quran and Surah Jummah and whatnot, that allude to the fact that it was the promised Messiah. We can't just take, you know, one hadith and that's it. That if it doesn't mention the name, that's it, you know, we're not going to accept this. We have to look at the whole picture. So, like, coming off that point, Muslim Sahib, the Prophet Messiah in his life, you know, many people ask this question, never explicitly and categorically mentioned that Khilafat will come after his demise. You know, like the Holy Prophet gave this hadith. So, you know, what's this all about? Is this true?
Fatih Sahib, I think it's important to remember that Hazrat Muslim Maud radiallahu anhu has explained this in one of his books as well, in one of his speeches. He's mentioned the second Khalifa of the Promised Messiah alayhi salam. He's mentioned that when someone loves someone so dearly, they cannot imagine being separated from that person. Now, the companions of the Promised Messiah alayhi salam, as we all know, as we do as well, we love the Promised Messiah alayhi salam so dearly. So the companions loved him so dearly, it was very difficult for them to even think of losing the Promised Messiah alayhi salam, think of him dying before them. There's even instances where young people, younger than me, who were like teenagers, went up to the Prophet Messiah alayhi salam when he was at the age of 70, right. And they went up to him and said, will you lead our funeral prayers when we pass away?
Yeah.
So they couldn't even conceive of losing him. So when that's why the Prophet Messiah alayhi salam, certain things are alluded to within their writings. Now, it's clear that in one of his last books, written in 1905, Al-Wasiyyat,
Al-Wasiyyat is a book, you know, like Muslim Sahib said, is written towards the end of the Prophet Messiah's life. It is available on alislam.org. You can get it there on PDF, put it onto your laptops, onto your iPads or whatnot. Yes, sorry.
Yeah, the Prophet Messiah alayhi salam, in this book, he's mentioned, he's alluded to Khilafat. He said that he's talking about prophethood and what follows it, as it's been mentioned in a hadith as well, that the Holy Prophet ﷺ has said that there's never been an instance where there's been prophethood and where Khilafat has not followed it. The Prophet Moses alayhi salam, after him there was Khilafat. The Prophet Jesus alayhi salam, after him there was Khilafat, and in some form it still exists even today.
Right.
But the Promised Messiah alayhi salam, he explains that Allah the Almighty manifests two kinds of power. This is from Al-Wasiyyat.
Yeah.
He says the first one is that he shows the hand of his power at the hands of his prophets themselves.
Right.
Then the second manifestation, talking about that, he says, when the death of a prophet comes about, difficulties and problems arise and the enemy feels stronger and thinks that things are in disarray and is convinced that now this Jamaat will become extinct. And even members of the Jamaat too are in quandary and their backs are broken. And some of the unfortunate ones choose paths that lead to apostasy, which right. We see happened in the time of Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu as well. Now, the Prophet Messiah alayhi salam, further on, he's explained that just as after the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the companions too were stricken with grief, became like those who lose their senses. Then Allah raised Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and showed for the second time the manifestation of his power and saved Islam. The Prophet Messiah alayhi salam gave a clear indication of what he means by the second manifestation. Right. He's referred to Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu's Khilafat.
Because Ibrahim Sahib, it's a very crucial point which Muslim Sahib just mentioned, that the Prophet Messiah alayhi salam in Al-Wasiyyat said that just how after the demise of the Holy Prophet sallam, Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu was elected in the same manner and he saved Islam, then, you know, the Khilafat was started. You know, of course, as a clear indication that after his demise, the same thing would happen.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, I will explain this point. Even about Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, even in the time of Muhammad sallam, before his demise, It was the Holy Prophet, you know, when Omar wanted to lead the prayers, as he was summoned to lead the prayers, then Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam heard his voice and he said, you know, once clearly, يَأْبَ ذَلِكَ, you know, اللَّهَ وَالْمُسْلِمُونَ. Allah, that means here, Allah and the believers or the Muslims want Abu Bakr in there to lead the prayers, and he led. What's the indication? But I go, this point is a very fine, you know, subtle point, if you allow me to go. Two points I want to explain this, because Masih Maud clearly, beside wasiyat, clearly mentioned that there will be khilafat. Before that, I want just, if you allow me to explain, you know, this point, Allah says, before I go, Allah says in the Holy Quran, مَا كَانَ اللَّهِ لِيَذَرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ عَلَى مَا أَنْتُمْ عَلَيْهِ حَتَّى يَمِيزَ الْخَبِيثَ مِنَ الطَّيِّبِ. Allah will never let you, as believers, in the condition you are, until He will separate the wicked from the good ones.
Right.
And then Allah says, إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. When Allah, whenever Allah selects a khalifa, there is always a kind of veil over the words of prophets beforehand. Somehow, for those who are wicked-minded, ill-minded, will not recognize.
Yeah.
Although it is clear, you'll be amazed. I will read something from Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam. What he said about, did he speak about, beside wasiyat, about khulafa? Clearly, many times, I will give you some, what he said.
So now you're saying, apart from wasiyat, the Prophet also?
Yes, he spoke. I give you an example, what Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam said in Hamamatul Bushra, 1893. You see, amazing, before wasiyat.
Which is a book written in Arabic language.
Yes, Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam wrote this book in Arabic, you know, volume 7, page 225. He says, then the promised Messiah, he indicates here, there is a hadith of the Holy Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasalam, and then he says, then the promised Messiah or one of his khulafa would travel towards Damascus. That means when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam made it very clear, the promised Messiah and his has the khulafa.
Right.
Which are in red khulafa, of course, of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then Masih Maud writes about this, which makes he was well aware that after his demise there will be khulafa. Even more, I will go other. There are other proofs from the books of Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, beside the wasiyat. He says, in the green announcement or the green pamphlet, when Bashir the first passed away, then he wrote two tools. Two means how to get Allah's mercy. One, he said there will be trials. In order, when you overcome the trials, you will get the mercy of Allah.
Right.
And then he says the second way of sending mercy is to send messengers and prophets. 1888, before Hamamatul Bushra. Divinely inspired scholars, awliya, and khulafa. Messengers, prophets, scholars, awliya, and khulafa. So that people may be guided to the right path through their leadership and guidance. I will not go in depth. Then he says, so Allah, the Most High, decreed that the progeny of this humble one may manifest both these forms.
Right.
How Masih Maud at that time, already before wasiyat, spoke, there will be.
So essentially what you're saying, the progeny will manifest this.
That means among the khulafa, there will be among his own progeny, among them, there will be khulafa. And this has been fulfilled.
Right.
In 1888, he didn't claim to be the promised Messiah.
Of course.
Moreover, there is one, if you allow me as last, 1.5 months before his demise, the promised Messiah says, the Sufis have said that the person who is to be the Khalifa after a Sheikh, or Rasul, or a Nabi, is the first one who is inspired by God to accept the truth. The death of a Rasul is like an earthquake, a danger, but Almighty provides reassurance through this Khalifa. Now, Masih Maud says about him, Sheikh, he himself, Allah says about him, أنت شيخ الزمان الذي لا يضع وقته. You are the Sheikh whose time is not wasted.
Yeah.
He is the Nabi, called by Allah. He's called by Allah Rasul, and he's called by Allah Shaykh. In all these connotations, as a messenger of Allah, he says he will be followed by a Khalifa. There are so many other indications, but from this point I just mentioned that Khilafat is very clear. But still, there is always a veil over this kind of words. Those who are purified or pure-minded will understand it. And this is what happened in the time of Abu Bakr.
Of course, the time of the Prophet.
This is what happened.
I think Ibrahim Sab has explained it beautifully. He's given many references. But it's also very important to remember that the companions of the Promised Messiah, alayhi salam, understanding his writings, understanding all his references, also unanimously agreed. The first consensus was that they all unanimously agreed that there must be Khilafat. Right. Even we know about history of Ahmadiyyat, that the Khwaja Kamaluddin Sahib, what his role was as well. He was a secretary of Sadr Anjuman Ahmadiyya. And on behalf of all the members, he sent the following circular letter to all the branches of the community. And in that circular himself, he writes that in compliance with the bequest mentioned in Al-Wasiyyat, all the notables of Sadr Anjuman Ahmadiyya who were present in Qadian and the members of the family of the Promised Messiah, and with the permission of the mother of the faithfuls, wife of the Promised Messiah alayhi salam, and the entire community then present in Qadian, which numbered 1,200 souls, it was unanimously agreed that the most respectable first Khalifa would be the Khalifa. And he's mentioned this clearly. So even the companions, understanding the writings of the Promised Messiah alayhi salam, and all these mentions that Ibrahim Sahib has mentioned as well.
I think that's a very important point, especially for our viewers, that the group which deviated away from Khilafat, initially they accepted Hazrat Khalifat al-Masih al-Awwal, who was the first Khalifa after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they sent a circular around telling all the Ahmadis, you know, wherever they were, that we have taken bayat at his hand. That coming off from this, we actually have a question in from Ahmed Saab. As a reminder to all our viewers, remember this is an interactive program, so please do send in your comments, your queries, your questions, anything regarding the topic of Khilafat which pops up in your mind. And please, our lines are open. We have an email address which is on the screen, and you can text in your messages also. So we have a question in, Ibrahim Saab, from Amir. And he says that if Khilafat is chosen by God, and of course if Khilafat Ahmadiyya is divinely elected, then why is it that there is an electoral college and a board, and essentially there's people who elect the Khalifa? So, you know, how is this divinely connected?
You see, what when Allah says in Quran, Inni ja'alun fil ardi Khalifa, when I make there, I will appoint a Khalifa, then Allah spoke about Adam, or the Prophet, which represents a Prophet, or a Khalifa from Khulafa al-Rashideen, that they have such a knowledge that even the angels are not, you know, will not understand them in depth unless they see the things being fulfilled. Now, at this point, the person, Brother Amr Sahib, should understand that Allah's way of dealing is through His attributes, His laws of nature and spiritual, that's Rahman and Rahim. Right. When Allah says, وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ, Allah Himself said, وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, that's conditional. Which means Allah says, one side it is a condition, and other side is a criterion. Condition in the sense, there should, when Allah creates a prophet, and that prophet, through Allah's hands, creates a community of believers. Yeah. You just imagine that again, Muhammad Sassan passed away, and someone just comes and says, I am the Khalifa, no elections, Allah has selected me. The people will start again, can you show us your proof? He should again get revelations from God, and again to show and his enemy and the hypocrites to show that he is on the right way.
So essentially what you're saying is that in the Quran, we learn from this, from the Quran, that there's already a body of believers that the Prophet has already made.
Exactly.
And from those body of believers, of course, a Khalifa is elected. And it can't be that, you know, someone randomly says that I'm the Khalifa.
Exactly. And that is the condition. He creates a prophet, a body of believers. But in the same wine, it is a criterion that those people should be in that condition of spirituality to believe and perform good deeds, which, of course, is so comprehensive. And so this...
Establishment of the institution of Khilafat also shows the truth of the community as well.
Absolutely. The fact, in reality, is a, is a, is here a trial from God, because Allah again will not let them. Allah will choose, these people will select, as long as they are united, as Allah said, the Khalifa, يُؤَلِّفْ بَيْنِ الْقُلُوبِ, he's the one who unites the hearts. As long as the hearts are united, they will be able to select the Khalifa. And after Ali radiallahu anhu, the Muslims were so divided, although the companions were there, they were not able to select the Khalifa, which seems that the spiritual conditions is now so low that Allah took that reward of Khilafat away from them. Right. May Allah protect us.
So coming off that point, Muhsin Sahib, we have a question in, it's a text message actually from Zahir Sahib. And so we've been talking about, you know, how Khilafat is initially elected through the guidance of God Almighty. He asks, how do we know that the Khilafat of Ahmadiyya is divinely guided after that?
Fatir, I think the proof of something being divinely guided is divine support.
Right,
so if you see divine support with our institution of Khilafat, with our Khulafa, then that is clear that Allah is has, you know, approved that system. Allah is supporting that Khalifa and the system which is running under that Khalifa. Now, we see from the time of the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam, when there was very small number of Ahmadis and they were limited as well. Now that the Jamaat has expounded and through the 100 years of Khilafat, over 100 years of Khilafat, this Jamaat has spread to the corners of the world. And it is spreading on a daily basis. We've in the verse of Ayat Istikhlaf, Allah says that He would establish the religion through the Khulafa, through the Khalifa. And we see that in the establishment of the religion, our Khalifas have done a lot of work in terms of Taleem, in terms of teaching, and also Tarbiyat as well, in terms of the raising of the...
Coming off this point, Ibrahim Sahib, you know, when Hazrat Khalifa Masih Thani radiallahu anhu was elected as a Khalifa at his tender age, you know, at that time, you know, it's famous that the Lahori Jamaat, the people who went away, they actually took away the treasures of the Jamaat, the financial support which the Jamaat even had. And can you tell for our viewers, you know, what actually happened after that when Hazrat Khalifa Masih Thani radiallahu anhu, you know, raised the Jamaat on supports which, you know, through the temporal side weren't even there?
You see, my brother, in reality, the election of the second Khalifa, when Allah elected him to this office of Khilafat, that was in reality the fulfillment of that divine prophecy of the promised son, you know, by the promised Messiah. Why? All, he was such young age, a person of such young age, but I want to say beside that, when Khalifa in 1911, because it is not something suddenly, in 1911, Khalifa al-Awwal fell ill, radiallahu anhu. Then what happened, he wrote in a letter, according to the practice model of Abu Bakr, and in the letter he put Khalifa Mahmud. Already, he was such a great personality in such a young age. It doesn't mean, as the Lahoris want to say, out of jealousy towards him, and even they want to undermine his Khilafat, but in reality, Allah supported him. The same day, when he became Khalifa in those days, Allah told him, through revelations, every step he took, I will shatter them. And look what happened in the next 52 years. Let us look to the two Jama'ats. I will call them more a sect. Yeah. Look to the Jama'at Ahmadiyya, you know, the Khalifatul Masih al-Thani, who give the Tafsir al-Kabir, who established the system of Jama'at Tahrik al-Jadid and Waqf al-Jadid, and spread Ahmadiyyat all over the world at that moment. And he reigned this community for 52 years. And he got the help from Allah in every step he took. I go moreover, when we go, he wrote a book, Truth About the Split in the Beginning Time. Yeah. When we look in the 60s, we saw the Lahori Jamaat were nowhere. Even then, I will tell you, because we are speaking about trials, Allah put even the companions of Masih Maud and many followers at that time of Khalifa Thani in a kind of trial, because it seems that in the beginning, this Lahori group, they got many people who converted and followed them. But at last, Allah helped him. It is impossible. unless he didn't have even the typing machine has been taken by the Lahore Jama, typewriter has been taken by them. Yeah. Nothing, even nothing has been left. Out of nothing, this can be only from Allah. And I can tell you more if you allow me. I met a week ago one Yemeni.
Yeah.
He told me he doesn't know anything about Ahmadiyyat. He said, I went to Yemen. He lives here. Yeah. He said, I went to Yemen. He didn't know anything about Ahmadiyyat. He said, I needed for my wife to apply for visa for UK. He said, then, but we have no embassy in Yemen. We went to Egypt. He said, then suddenly I saw a dream or a vision, a person, you know, who signed the paper and said, your wife will get the visa. Right. And do you know who the person was? Yeah. That was Khalifa al-Masih al-Khamis.
Right.
My own mother, in the 90s, I can tell you, 9 years before accepting Ahmadiyyat, she saw in a dream Khalifa al-Masih al-Rabi', and she didn't know about Ahmed, never saw him. And that is, the angels are descending on the hearts of good-natured people, and they are attracting him. Ahmadiyyat is becoming bigger and greater. If I start, if Mustansir can continue this, about what Muslih Mu'awud did, it is, I can't say it in two minutes or three.
That's a very crucial and you know, very important point, that since the inception of Khilafat Ahmadiyyat, Khilafat has grown and grown and grown. I mean, Mustansir Sahib, you know, every year in our annual convention, which happens here in United Kingdom, His Holiness Hazrat Khalifat Masih al-Khamis, Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmad, may God be his helper, tells us how many people are joining the community, how through the guidance of Khilafat, we are building more mosques around the world.
And Father, that links in perfectly with, for example, the history of Ahmadiyyat, the Majlis-e-Ihrar.
Right.
They planned to completely wipe out Ahmadiyyat in 1934. Now, Hazrat Muslim Maud radiallahu anhu, at that time, around that time, he established another institution of Tehreek-e-Jadeed, and that went opposed to this, and it showed the greatness and the divine support that was with the community. And you know about Ziaul Haq, the president of Pakistan. How he stood up against the Khalifa of the time, Hazrat Khalifa, the fourth Khalifa of the Prophet Messiah alayhi salam, what became of him? You just don't have to look far. This was only in 1989, I think.
Right.
And he was completely obliterated. He was completely destroyed. Why? Because he stood up against this divine system which was established by God Almighty. And that shows that divine support is with Khilafat and is with the community. Right. Apart from the activities we do, the spreading of the true message of Islam, divine support also shows its face every now and then as well, in terms like these signs that are manifest.
So, in conclusion, Jazakallah Ahmed Sahib and Zahid Sahib, it's categorically clear that the way we've been discussing is that the election which takes place after the demise of the Prophet is a mercy for the community at large. I mean, the Prophet comes and he builds a community of believers who believe in him and do good works. And then after he passes away, the community of believers come together and they elect the Khalifa through divine guidance, through the guidance of God Almighty himself. And that is a mercy for the Jamaat, for the community at large. Ibrahim Sahib, there's actually a question from Walid Niazi. He's only 14 years old. He asks, at the time of election, are there any signs of who will be the next Khalifa? I think this is a very interesting question.
I just can't say this about, because he speaks about the signs now.
Yeah.
We can say more the heavenly signs from Allah.
Right.
Yes, I think I will tell him, go to alislam.org, you know. There is a compilation of so many people beforehand who got so many dreams.
Right.
I just want, if you allow me, you know, yesterday, if I can mention even the name, there is nothing secret about this.
Right.
And one person who was in the election of 2003, and he is, I will tell his name, no problem.
Yeah.
You know, he is the Amir in the Middle East. And he said, when I went to the election, I had a person in my mind. Just imagine this for the viewers to know how Allah works.
Right.
This is just a person who was, I think, 36 years. He came to that election. He said, I was shocked. How can I be there? You know, how should we select someone? I don't know anything. He said, but I had my trust in Allah.
Right.
In the meanwhile, what he had someone in his mind.
Yeah.
And what he did when he went, he said, I was near the Fazl Mosque.
Yeah.
Look, I was at the Fazl Mosque. We were in groups waiting to enter in rows to enter the Fazl Mosque. Right. He said, that person was still in my mind. He said, then suddenly I saw two people coming in front of me to stand in a row behind me. One was our present Khalifa, and one was the Wakil al-A'la, we can say, in Pakistan. He said, when I look to the present Khalifa, I don't know who he is. Right. He was not known. People didn't know. Right. We don't know him. He said, I saw a flash, light coming just from his face to me entered my heart. I was shocked. What is happening with me? He said, when we entered in the mosque, just imagine how Allah helps. He said, then they said, just the name Mirza Masroor, Ayadullah Ibn Hassan Aziz. He said, I was thinking this is one someone else. He confused him, I don't want to mention the name, with someone else. He said, still, I didn't know who is that person. He said, then someone else stood up and he said, can you introduce when they are nominated? We want to see the people. You see, when I looked to the present Khalifa, he was sitting the left side when entered the mosque near the shoes, so humble. We didn't know him. He said, when that name has been mentioned, which has all the time was in my mind, I couldn't raise my hand. Allah had full control over me. Right. I had nothing. He said, I only know when they mentioned the name of our present Hazur Ayadullah, my hand just went this. He said, it is the will of Allah. I just, because he wants signs, I tell him, this is one of the signs I mentioned, and others, there are hundreds or thousands of people who saw this.
Of course. And Mr. Saab, even in Al-Wasiyyat, the Prophet Messiah, you know, clearly said that the person who will come as a second manifestation will be like a normal being, and people will think him to be a normal person, but he will, you know, take the Jamaat forward and he will spread the message of Islam. And of course we have, like Ibrahim Ikhlaf Sahib said, we have hundreds and hundreds of dreams and people even, you know, being guided by God Almighty, categorically telling them, for example, the Khalifa right now, that it will be Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmed, may God be his helper, who would be the next Khalifa. And so it's not their choice, it's the choice of God Almighty.
And it's always been a unanimous decision.
And it's been a unanimous decision, of course.
Also, one point I want to mention, when we mention about wasiyah, there's one very important point. Because when we speak about, I call them the Khawarij, those people who rebelled against Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu, right. And he was, of course, from the family of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Same happened because inni ma'aka wa ma ahlik, I'm with you and your family, O promised Messiah. Now what I want to say, Masih Maud says that the Qudra Thaniya, the second manifestation, second
the
power,
Qudra Thaniya, second
manifestation power, which Allah will show, will be only after my demise.
Right.
That's why he mentioned Abu Bakr, not in his lifetime.
Right.
The Anjuman, or the administrative body in the Jama'at, also said by Masih Maud, was already in the lifetime of Masih Maud. And moreover, I will tell you, look, Khalifa al-Awwal, but just for the people to understand, when he was also the chairman of that committee or the sadr of that committee, he removed himself from that. He said, and he put Khalifa Thani in that.
Right.
And what he said, look what he said. I declare in the name of Allah that Allah appointed me as Khalifa exactly as he appointed Adam, Abu Bakr, Omar as Khulafas.
So this is a quote of who?
A quote from Khalifa al-Awwal.
Okay, the first Khalifa.
Yes, related to this Lahoris, he said, Allah selected me as he appointed Adam, alayhi salam, Abu Bakr and Omar. He went further. He said, do you believe in this Anjuman? If anyone says that the Anjuman made me Khalifa, he utters a falsehood. Such thinking is destructive and should be totally avoided. Listen once more, no man made me Khalifa, nor do I consider any Anjuman capable of appointing a Khalifa. What I mean, he said even sometimes, Anjuman was just an administrative
body.
Right,
so he said basically it's God Almighty who has chosen me.
Exactly.
Musul Sahib, there's a question in from Abbas Sahib from Canada, and he asks a very interesting question. He says that, how do you differentiate between Khilafat Ahmadiyya and that from the so-called, you know, Khilafat of ISIS, of al-Baghdadi, and you know, what have you? What's the difference?
Fatih, I think it's very important to remember the verse of Ayat Istikhlaf when we discuss this as well. Because Allah the Almighty has promised in Ayat Istikhlaf, which is Surah Nur, verse chapter 24, verse 56, if you count Bismillah, it's verse 56.
Right.
Allah the Almighty has said that He's promised the believers from amongst you, who do good works, that He will surely make them successors in the earth. And some of the conditions of Khilafat being established have also been mentioned, that they would offer their prayers, they would observe prayer and give zakat and obey the messenger.
Yeah.
Now, to what extent do you see that happening with ISIS and this Abu Bakr Baghdadi? What extent are they following the message of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam?
I mean, we could look at the conditions in Syria right now.
Exactly. If they're going out slaughtering people, at no instant will you find that this Khalifa of ISIS has ever mentioned that he is the Khalifa of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There's no instance of that. Whereas the hadith we quoted in the beginning of the program, which you read out in English, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said that it would be Khilafat ala minhaj an-nabuwah, that it would be Khilafat on the precepts of prophethood. It would follow the prophethood of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And following the prophethood of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam means the teachings of the Quran, the teachings of ahadith, and it would spread the message of Islam, the true message of Islam. They would teach people to offer their prayers, as it says in Ayat Istikhlaf in the following verses. Teach people to offer their prayers. It would teach people to give zakat.
Right.
It would establish peace after fear.
I think that's a very crucial point, Ibrahim Sahib. You know, in the Quran, Surah An-Nur, verse 56, at the end, God Almighty says that peace will be established.
Min ba'di khawfim amna.
Right.
This he said, yes, as Musansir Sahib says here, لا يبدلنه من بعد خوفهم أمنا.
Yeah.
Here is the opposite. He will exchange, لا يبدلنهم بعد أمنا خوفا.
This is
exactly the opposite. Instead of fear, to change it, to transform it into security and peace, he changed the condition of peace, security into some horrifying, you know, picture, even more than that.
Yeah.
Allah says in the Holy Quran, وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ كُنُوا مَعَ الصَّادِقِينَ. Our Khalifa, present Khalifa in London, we try to be near to him to be purified.
Yes, yes.
Before Allah said, يُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُوا الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ. Before even explaining the book, just to be near to the Khalifa of your time. That is why we should be attached to him. Our hearts are purified. We are feeling improved in spiritual condition. Now, my question is, that means that Khalifa should be visible, not Imam al-Ghaib or something.
And this point which you just said, that the Khalifa should be visible.
Visible.
In a recent sitting with His Holiness Hazrat Khalifa Masih al-Khamis, Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmed, may God be his helper, he quoted referred to a recent piece, a magazine, who said that the Khalifa is one who goes out and meets people asks them of their problems and resolves their problems.
Yeah.
But we don't see al-Baghdadi.
But first we had bin Laden,
right,
who was hiding somewhere in the combs or in these caves. Then we had someone suddenly with the same ideology but called himself a Khalifa,
right,
and hiding himself in name of Allah. Do you know Masih Maud spoke about sunnatillah? Do you know any sunnah, the nature of Allah and the system of Allah? Do you know any prophet who was, or Khalifa who was hiding? May Allah protect us. I will tell more. If he had the courage, Khalifa is more. Khalifa will sacrifice every atom. Our Khalifa and all the Khulafa will sacrifice every atom if they are persecuted.
Exactly.
Why is he hiding? Is he fearing that he's not behaving according to the Sharia?
Even the example of, you know, Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu, he used to walk the streets, he used to see, you know, if the Muslims are doing well, and if they're not doing well, he would go to the Bayt al-Mal, in the treasury, and pick up food and give it
and
to them.
Exactly. Even
the Khalifa has no fear of anyone other than Allah.
Right.
And
right.
even Brother Fatir and Musansir, something very important. Beside this, to change it in security and peace, there is also لَا يُمَكِنَنَّ لَهُمْ دِينَهُمْ. He will establish the religion. Tell me, in Middle East, I want to know his last 1 year or something. Did he, even in his own region, if he is there, you know, what did he do? What is his influence there? Positive influence. He should be the ambassador in the world for peace.
And the upsetting thing is, that, Mr. Sahib, now the image of Khilafat, you know, in the West, of those people who aren't Muslims and even amongst Muslims, has been distorted. And people think Khilafat to be a negative thing and something which causes corruption and which causes terror. But looking at Khilafat Ahmadiyya, this is not the case.
Exactly. And I think it's important to remember that anyone who claims themselves to be a Khalifa, they are not automatically a Khalifa. Right. Because he's also mentioned that the people made him the Khalifa.
Right.
Whereas we know that God Almighty appoints the Khalifa himself. We know that during the dark ages of Islam, you mentioned the hadith of monarchical despotism and the monarchs who were tyrannical as well. They called themselves Khalifa during history. They called themselves the Khalifa, but they did not believe themselves to be the spiritual caliphs of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Even though they gave themselves the title of a Khalifa, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in that hadith had not given them that title. He just spoke of them as Mulkan Adhan and Mulkan Jabariya, as monarchical despotism and people who are being tyrannical.
Right.
So they were not given the title of Khilafat by the Holy Prophet ﷺ himself. Allah gives that title, right? The Holy Prophet ﷺ gave that title in a hadith. So it's clear that it has to be a system which is established by God and not by the people.
Right.
I think, and also a very important point, it is sometimes, this is Allah's system. Yeah. Allah is the one who sent, هو الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهر على دين كله. It is Allah who sent the message, the Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that message to be sent all over the world. After the death of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, yes, the Sharia was complete, but his mission should be spread all over the world.
Yes.
And that is one of the tasks, yatlu alayhim ayati. Here, the effect when Allah says that he will show them the signs, yatu alim ayati.
Yes.
That means the Qurans will be translated, the mosques will be built, all the tafsir of Quran will be spread over the world, the peace will be spread over all of the
world. And of course, under the guidance of our Khalifa right now,
absolutely,
that is happening.
And moreover, I tell you, these people are in reality, why does Allah do this?
Yeah.
Because Allah wants to show the Muslims, the elect one by Allah, the Messiah has come. You got all your dreams. You wanted pan-Arabism.
Yeah.
You didn't get it.
Yeah.
You wanted to go through with the communism. It didn't help. You were with the Americans. It didn't help you. Now your dream was to have Khilafat. Even that is not helping you.
And regarding this, the whole issue of Khilafat, and like I alluded to before, it's a great dissatisfaction that people are going away from Khilafat. His Holiness Hazrat Mirza Mansur Ahmed, may God Almighty be his helper, stated the following regarding Khilafat and the West and people's conception. He said, "The West fears it might have to one day deal with Caliphate, but the West is already dealing with Khilafat in its pure form with Ahmadiyyat, which has existed for 122 years without any notion of a new world order or a Muslim ruler." And Khilafat's been here, and within the Jamaat, it's been something which has only spread peace. Jazakallah for that, and Jazakallah for your question also. Viewers, reminder again, do send in your comments, your queries, your questions regarding Khilafat. Our lines are open, you can send in your text, you can send in by email also. We have another question here by Melissa from London. And she's texted in and she asks, the caliphs of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had the empire too, they had temporal power also. So how do we justify the purely spiritual caliphate of the promised Messiah? So what she is saying is that, how come the khulafa of the promised Messiah don't have any temporal power?
Fatih, I think it's important to remember the purpose of the advent of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In the Holy Quran, Allah the Almighty has explained this as four distinct roles, which are all spiritual in their aspect. It says that yatlu alayhim ayatika, that he will recite the signs of Allah upon them. Yuallimuhumul kitab, that he will teach them the book and the law, and wal hikmata, and wisdom, and wa yuzakkihim, he will purify them. These are the four roles of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as explained by the prayer of the Prophet Abraham as well. Now, look at the history of prophets as well. All prophets came to teach the people about God, to teach them the spiritual realms, right? So when the prophet does have statesmanship as well, have temporal power as well, that is not as one of his aims. For example, we know that the majority of the life of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was spent where he was not a statesman.
Right.
He had no political power, he had no kind of power at all when the time when he was in Makkah, which was the majority of his time. He had no temporal power. Was he not a prophet back then?
Yeah.
No, he was. And that was his main aim. And when he went to Medina, that's when he was made unanimously voted and declared the statesman.
Right.
Now, that was not his purpose. We know in Bayt-e-Uqba,
yeah.
Before the migration towards Medina, there was in that Bayt, in that initiation, it was clear that there was no mention of any kind of power before his migration to Medina.
Right.
It said that the reward for accepting Islam, when the people asked the Holy Prophet ﷺ, what would be our reward for accepting Islam? The Holy Prophet ﷺ didn't mention any kind of wealth or any kind of money or any kind of temporal power. He said that it wasn't money and wealth. Your reward is Jannah. It's heaven. That when you accept Islam, you will get Jannah. You will get heaven.
Right. So Ibrahim's alluding off that point. Essentially, what we're saying here is that the purpose of the Holy Prophet ﷺ and his advent wasn't worldly powers.
Exactly. You see, Quran, even for Sister Melissa here, the Quran made it very clear. Quran says you have the Muhammad in Mecca and Muhammad in Medina. There is, Allah spoke about it, you can say, Muhammad Muhammad Rasulullah walladhina ma'ahu ashiddau ala al-kufar. Chapter 48, Surah Al-Fatah,
yeah.
Allah speaks about the dispensation of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, which will be divided in two eras.
Right, right.
One, the first era,
yeah.
Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was the only personality, you see, the only messenger,
yeah.
who combined in him
yeah.
the beauty and the power, the majesty.
Right.
In Mecca, he lived under Abu Sufyan.
Yeah.
Yes? And what he did, he obeyed the law, like Jesus in Israel, in Palestine.
Okay.
Now, what happened, exactly as Mustansir in reality said, his purpose was never to be a political leader and to have an empire, whatever.
But he was elected.
Yes, he was in Medina by the Jewish,
yeah.
by the idol worship, by the Muslims, all of them elected as a head of the state. Now, Masih Ma'ud speaks about that is why in Mecca he was only praising, so much praising Allah and sacrificing Ahmed, the one who prays. In Medina, he was the one who gave that freedom of speech. You know what happened? I tell you, these wars, Allah wanted him,
yes.
this complete prophet, in every facet of life, of human life, how to behave as a general, how to behave as a political leader. And Muhammad, it was necessary to have all this, you know, all these capacities and abilities in him. Now, it so happened, unfortunately,
yes.
that after Muhammad, after his demise, Abu Bakr should have inherited also this, because he was a political leader.
Right.
But as Mustansir said, Quran doesn't speak about this. Now, moreover, I tell you, Quran is never in favor of wars. Do you know, until the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, do you know how many Muslims there were? Only 3,000 maximum.
Right, exactly.
And after that, because when they got the peace, no war, they got more than 3,000. It's extended to 10,000 and more. Last what I want to say,
right.
and there is a prophecy that a time will come, and Muhammad himself says it. This is the answer. Yada al-harb, he will make end to war, and there Islam, yada al-jizya, there will be nothing have to have with wars, no imperium, and then Muhammad's awesome second coming or the coming of the Messiah will be like Muhammad's awesome in Mecca or like Jesus in Palestine, and he will come to show them Islam has never been spread by sword, and you will see this is a spiritual community and the power of the power of that religion in
yeah.
its argument and spirituality
right.
will conquer this planet
exactly.
and this is what is happening to Ahmadiyyat.
We should remember the meaning of Khilafat, which is successorship, and the role of the Prophet ﷺ was spiritual. He had statesmanship, but that was not his main purpose, and the promised Messiah alayhi salam being a Khalifa of the Holy Prophet ﷺ and our Khulafa also being Khalifas, they have that same spiritual role. That's why in Ayat Istikhlaf, which we've been mentioning constantly in this program as well, it talks about the role of the Khalifa is to establish the religion.
Right.
It's not to establish, you know, worldly power or any political power or statesmanship. It clearly mentions that it's to establish the religion, it's to establish faith and give peace in the world.
Right. So Ibrahim Sahib, we have a question from a person with the same name as yours. Ibrahim Watara from Mali. He says, could you please explain to him in Arabic the concept of Imam Mahdi?
Okay. Before that, if you allow me, Fatsa, because in I think last program there was, and that's related to Melissa's question about why this science and power after the Khulafa Rashidin. I just want if you to, yes. just to answer about this. You know, in the Holy Quran, it was it said, "Kama istakhlafa alladhina min qablihim." That Khilafat of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم will have some resemblance to that Khilafat of Musa alayhi salam. No, Musa says in Quran, and remember when Musa said, I will not read in Arabic, O my people, call to mind Allah's favor upon you when he appointed prophets among you and made you kings. Right. In Arabic, وَجَعَلَ فِيكُمْ أَنْبِيَاءَ وَجَعَلَكُمْ مُلُوكًا, which means Allah give the blessings to the Bani Israel, to the Jewish, the Judah, to the followers of Musa, that they had spiritual and temporal power.
Yeah.
And that should also, according to the decree of Allah, be fulfilled in the Ummah of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And this is what went on.
Jazakallah for that. So the concept, coming back to Ibrahim Saab's question, Mahdi. Could you just explain to him,
I will be very briefly, very short.
Yeah.
Imam, when Muhammad, I make it short, when Muhammad SAW said, لا مهدي إلا عيسى in Ibn Majah.
Yeah.
Mahdi has been used in the Holy Quran.
Right.
هؤلاء أئمة يهدون بإمة.
Can you explain this in Arabic?
Yeah, in Arabic. Imam is the Imam, of course, the leader or the Imam himself. Mahdi, the guided one.
Okay, just last point, could you explain it in actual Arabic? Can you speak in Arabic?
Arabic?
Yeah, he wants you to speak in Arabic briefly.
okay. الله وضح في الأحاديث في ابن ماجة لما يقول الله عز وجل لما يقول محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم نقرأ في الحديث في ابن ماجة لا مهدي إلا عيسى. هنا المهدي مذكور في سورة الأنبياء, هنا يقصدها الله يقول في القرآن في سورة هؤلاء أئمة يهدون بأمرنا, بأن هم يتلقوا هذه الهداية من الله عز وجل والله الذي يختارهم. بهنا كان محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم يشير إلى هذه النقطة أن عيسى عليه السلام فهو يكون نبي الله, كما أشار محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى ذلك في صحيح المسلم 4 مرات, قال إنه نبي الله والنبي الله, يعني لا مهدي إلا عيسى. نحن يقصد الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم لا النبي يكون إلا عيسى عليه السلام. هذا لماذا قال في الأحد في سمن في الحديث لا نبي بينني وبينه إنه هو عيسى يكون نبي الله.
Ibrahim, thank you very much. For those people who do understand the Arabic language and would rather prefer to watch all these answers and queries in Arabic, we do have in the beginning of every month a live Arabic program, Al-Hawar Al-Mubashir, and also on Tuesdays we have Sabil Al-Huda, which also are in Arabic language and they address all these topics. You can send your questions in. As a last finishing point, Musanta Saab, the question is from Qasid Faruqi Saab from Woking. He says, very briefly, will Khilafat continue until Qiyamah, till the Day of Judgment?
Fatih Saab, yes. It will, but obviously it has its conditions as well. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the hadith we've been basing the whole program on, at the end of it he says that ثم تكون خلافة على منهاج النبوة,
right.
And as part of the actual narration of the hadith, at the end it says ثم سكت,
right.
That at the end he stayed quiet. So he didn't mention this Khilafat ending at all. And the promised Messiah alayhi salam has actually mentioned this Khilafat as the second manifestation. He said that, and that second manifestation will be better for you,
right.
Because it is everlasting, the continuity of which will not end till the Day of Judgment. And Hazrat Khalifatul Masih II, the second Khalifa of the promised Messiah alayhi salam, also mentions this as well. And he says that it is apparent that Caliphate in Ahmadiyyat shall continue to exist for a very long period, far beyond our conjectures. What happened in the early history of Islam will not necessarily be repeated. What happened then was peculiar to the circumstances that came into existence at that time and cannot be considered a general rule. But also we should remember that this Khilafat is a continuation of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Thank you very much, Ibrahim Saab. Thank you very much also, Jazakallah, to you both. In conclusion, viewers, it's categorically clear that the Khilafat, which the Holy Prophet ﷺ prophesied about, that was to come in the latter days, was none other than the Khilafat of the Promised Messiah, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmed, may peace be upon him, and which is a Khilafat which will last to the Day of Judgment and which will bring peace to the world. We will be discussing the same topic next week, inshallah. Jazakallah to the panelists today. Until next time, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Mahmood karke chodenge hum haq ko aashkar roe zameen ko kha hilana pade hame jayenge hum jaan ke jaan.